can we harness school effects in ed finance policy? And as I said, because it's a new university, I'm going to start with an abbreviated, and I promise, abbreviated history of education finance. I'm really going to sum it up in three phases. The first phase, and you didn't even have to live it all over the last 40 years, but that was called leveling up. And in this first phase, which we call leveling up, is where in the 70s and 80s, where we added a lot of money to public education. And I call it leveling up because there are big batches of students out there that were not served well at all. Students with disabilities weren't getting services. You may have read Savage Inequalities, a sort of famous book about inequities. And if you look at those over the sort of growth we had in expenditures over the decades, after inflation, from 70 to 80 and 80 to 90, we saw about 35 or 36% growth from each of those decades in our expenditures on public education, even after accounting for the number of students and inflation, as I said. And then it still grew, but it didn't grow as fast. So that was that first phase we'll call leveling up, and that's this chunk of time here. And these are overlapping phases. But we did get quite a bit more for that. I mean, during this phase, some of you are here for the morning workshop. No, we added a lot of adults to public education. Back in 1970, there were 58 full-time equivalent adults in public schools for every 1,000 students. That grew to 100 by 1980, and it grew again. And we've seen some growth and some decline, but really not the pace of growth that we had during that early set of decades. And so as we kind of got toward the end of what I call leveling up, people started asking about the money. And they said this question, not everybody, but the question sort of was percolating. And those who were here this morning know the answer, as do all of you. True or false? So I'm big on these quiz questions, just in case you're wondering. But two schools with roughly the same mix of students can spend the same amount of money and get different results. Yes, true, they can. And so that idea was how people thought about what was going on with their expenditures. They looked at data on expenditures and outcomes, and this is some data I brought from Washington State. These are all elementary schools in Washington State that are high poverty. They're just the high poverty elementary schools. Each dot is an elementary school. And on the horizontal axis, that's spending. And on the vertical, I brought was reading scores. So we're looking, we got rid of the really big schools and the really small schools. So it's really just like your typical high poverty elementary schools in Washington State. And what we found is, you know, really a very weak relationship between spending and outcomes, right? If there was a strong relationship, you would see all of those schools sort of clustered in an upwardly sloping scatter, right? That means the more money we spend, the better the performance. And we don't see that here. So this was after our leveling up phase, and the next round of thinking was, I wonder if it matters. If it matters how the money is spent, right? Have you heard of that a lot? So that was how I characterized phase two, which is a lot of the 90s and early 2000s, and we'll call that the best practices phase of education finance. And during that phase, there was a whole lot of research done by people like me and other people on what matters in education. So if you can target your class sizes to smaller amounts and have some sort of at least, you know, minimal salaries for teachers, do reading coaches matter? Paraprofessionals that suggest are poorly related to outcomes. So we spend money on full-day kindergarten technology, those kinds of things. Are those more robust expenditures where we will get a better relationship between spending and outcomes? And that thinking fueled a whole lot of policies, requirements at the state level for targeting funds towards specific schooling inputs. And not just at the state, but districts, you know, got very into this. School boards wanted to know what the money was spent on. Legislatures, we've talked to a lot of legislatures who said, I want to put this money in for PD or for, you know, extra seven period days in the high schools, or you name it. There was a lot of prescription going on. And some of that during that time crept into the federal policy as well. And so that leads us to our next quiz question. Two schools with roughly the same mix of students can spend the same amount of money in the same way and get different results. Also true, right? And as I admitted to our morning workshop group, this is really honestly a devastating finding if you are an education finance researcher. It suggests that everything that you believed in almost isn't what the real big effect is here. That where you believe the data, I mean, I was an undergraduate math major. I love numbers, and I believe that inside the numbers were the answers to every problem in our country. And this finding alone, which we should have all known all along, right, shows that I was wrong. And this finding is why is that the case? Anybody who's worked in school sort of immediately says, of course that's true. Everything about schooling screams human processes, right? There's so much humanness in schooling between the way teachers relate to students, the kind of way that students relate to their communities, the parents relate to the school, all the other interpersonal dynamics that matter, that are underlined by behavior, which is not something that is really easy to quantify in financial metrics. And so once we sort of look at that reality, we realize that deep in there are something that we call school effects. And that's what this next phase is. And it turns out, the reason I brought this data from Washington State is because in Washington State, there really is pretty uniform spending. They do spend it on almost the same things from one school to the next because of the nature of the state formula. So there really are very set class sizes, as a statewide salary schedule, a staffing allocation from the state to all the schools that really dictates the mix of staff that they can have. And of course it adds up to a different amount per pupil across the state, but we're already in a place where we've regimented how the money is spent, and yet still we can look at two schools like these two that have the same amount of money, spend it in the same way, they're both serving poor kids, and they're getting wildly different outcomes. And so if we're going to recognize that there's this element of school effects in school finance, then the task here is not to ignore that, but to figure out how to harness it. And that's what I'm calling phase three, which is how do we leverage school effects? And that's what I think the new era of school finance is, and we'll be hearing a lot more about this in the next decade, I suspect. And what we're really after here is productivity. And productivity, I often say, is this really nasty word that people hate to say in public education, but really when you unpack it, It's a ratio. You have outcomes in the numerator and inputs or dollars in the denominator. And what we're trying to do here when we talk about productivity is grow the numerator. We're saying at whatever expenditure level you are, how do you get more outcomes? And that's where this new phase is. So I just have one more quick bit of data, because this is the data portion of your luncheon. But this is some data on small rural districts. And rural districts are like schools because most of them are a school. It's sort of, you know, they have the kindergarten through 12th grade all in one building. And so what we did when we studied them was we found that if we narrowed into a certain band of rural districts across the country, that we got the same sort of scatter plot where spending and outcomes are arrayed in these four quadrants. And if we just look at that batch right there with the red square, those are the ones that are high performing but are not spending more than their peers, right? So they spend average or less, and they seem to beat the odds with the kids that they have. So we call those our ROI superstars, right? Those are the ones that we don't know how they do it, I did this great study where we said, let's go in and figure it out. First thing we did is, can we explain it with demographics or size or any other measurable characteristic? And the answer was no. And the next thing we said, let's look into their spending patterns then and figure out why they get such better outcomes. What are they spending their money on? See, I did it again. I said, what are we spending their money on? Because the answer's got to be in there, right? And it's not to say that there aren't any learnings, but we really thought we were going to find out the patterns. And actually, I'm going to share this data with you. So if you're looking for the secret sauce for high-performing rural districts, you'll see we pulled out just some of their numbers. You can see all the other rural districts are on the right there, the percentage they spend on instruction and on student support and things like that. And now brace yourself. You're going to get to see how the superstars spend their money. I mean, it really could not have found less of an effect, right? In this case, it wasn't in the money. And so the answer to that one, is it in the spending patterns, was no. So we ended up having to do a study that involved a whole lot of interviewing of people and getting to know their districts and so on. And what we found that was there was no single factor, no program, no reform strategy was ever identified. But there were patterns in the way that they talked that were compared to their peers. And they said things like the importance of relationships. They talked about their students as individuals. They used data to help individuals, not data to run systems. They talked about staff buy-in, respect, community as a partner. They talked about things like flexibility and self-reliance and ingenuity. And they were really trying to fix problems that emerged in their district. They were always trying to fix something or improve on it. And they talked about very conscious trade-offs in the money. So again, I'm going to remind you that I'm a math major, and there I was doing a study that was focusing on relationships and self-reliance. This is so not where I thought I was going to take my career. It was all this behavioral stuff. So that's our question then, is how is it that we can go about setting up finance policy to leverage these school effects? And just to set the stage for our panel, I'll let you know that there are sort of three ideas out there on what finance policy looks like that's designed to leverage this. And the ideas are that it needs to start with equitable, adequate, student-driven funding, so the money goes for the kids, and that there has to be flexibility or autonomy to foster school ownership. And without that, you won't have the kind of ingenuity and the behaviors that we just talked about. And lastly, there needs to be information systems, both that we can track spending and outcomes to the school level, and also to acknowledge for accountability, and so that those in the system can search for answers. But these are open issues. They are not decided or determined or concluded in the research, and that's why we've asked this excellent panel up here to tell you what all this would mean for people in different positions in our system.